When we tell a winery story, we often begin with the vineyards and the terroir. In episode one of our three-part look at Frind Estates, we chose to disrupt the narrative and begin with owner Markus Frind's desire to harness technology and data while he waits for his vineyards, some 750 acres under development, to join the game. In part two, we look at production and speak with senior winemaker Eric Von Krosigk, who with decades of experience in traditional winemaking is rewriting his playbook, having fun putting together one of the most technically advanced wineries in North America.
How does tech fit in for you?
Tech fits in really nicely. I mean, I've never had the opportunity to play with this amount of tools on this level. You know, we get to play with both conventional and a lot of stuff that I really didn't know existed till Markus did the research. He said, what about this and what about that? And I go, I don't know. In most wineries' wheelhouse, you know, you're looking to upgrade a piece a year, and usually not on new tech because it's usually something more fundamental. So it's a very unique opportunity.
Is there something we can talk about that people might understand or
sure.
that we could relate to? At least we could relate to the quality of the wine coming out of the tank or
yeah, absolutely.
Barrel.
So we have a lot of technology.
What's your favorite?
Oh, the STARS unit has to be my favorite.
The yeah. STARS unit.
Yeah, so the STARS is a unit where we stabilize the wine in a single pass going through a machine, and it's electrodialysis machines. And what it does is it's just exchanging ions, is taking out potassium or calcium ions and stabilizing the wine that way. But it's so gentle on the wine. We don't, like normally we'd load it up into a tank, freeze it down for 5 to 10 days. But during that time, when you have it down to -5 Celsius, A, you waste a lot of energy, but you're also open to oxidation.
Mm-hmm.
So the wines often, they dull a bit in that process. And we, this way we can filter, cold stabilize, single pass, we save about, you know, 2.5, almost 3% of the wine.
So this is taking out like the tartrates in a white wine or the wine diamonds, that sort of thing, cleaning
yeah.
up the wine, but not hurting the wine.
Yeah, super gentle.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, it comes yeah. out beautiful. We also have another one of my favorite things to use is we have 3 optical sorting units. And so we can cut the grapes 7 different ways just going through those optical sorters because we can measure chlorophyll, we can do size, we can do color. It's pretty amazing.
And they're very fast, I understand.
8 feet a second.
8 feet a second.
yeah, it
yeah.
just goes by in a blur.
Yeah.
Nobody can sort that fast.
And are you worried at all, like, obviously it's great to have technology, are you worried that wine is not technical in some ways to me, but how do you sleep at night, or how do you bring it together?
How do you marry the two?
Yeah.
So, in essence, all we've done is, in some ways I say, you know, all this equipment gives me the best assistant winemaker I never had.
Okay.
Because all we're doing, like, the grapes have to be grown. 80% of the quality still comes from the vineyard. You can't magic that. But mm-hmm. what we're doing is we're taking out the green, and we're taking out the mold, and we're taking out the bugs and the sticks and the leaves and the twigs and the dirt.
Mm-hmm.
And we're able to also then say, okay, berry size has an impact, so we can sort by berry size. So
sure.
we're just taking that cluster and just dividing up what's in the cluster.
Yeah.
And that is a huge advantage.
Is it more wine-related than people-related, or like, do you have less people, or is it just better for making wine? How would you describe the way that you're using this tech?
Oh, I say actually we had to hire more people to use the tech in a weird way. Like, we're automating everything,
right.
but we're also, instead of going to large batches, we've gone to small batches, so it actually takes more people.
Mm-hmm.
But even in the lab, because we're doing a lot more research, we have a full lab, like 4 people in the lab. So for a winery of our size, we actually have more people per caseload.
So a lot more research. Short story is, what is it you're researching about? Cabernet or Syrah, or what is it? Tannins? I don't know.
Everything, really. Because we bring the grapes in, but then we look back, you know, from the start, from the individual vineyards, like what happened? What happened in that growing season? Why do we have these pyrazines or these tannins or this structure? And then we take it back to the growing. What can we do to influence in the vineyard to get the ripeness levels that we're looking at? What do we play with? Irrigation levels, we play with nutrients, we play with, you know, water deficit, but, you know, also just, you know, manipulating the crop itself.
Markus mentioned a lot about small batches. Is that another passion of yours or his? Because
no,
that's a lot of work.
It's a lot of work. I love small batches because
yeah.
it actually lets us see what's actually growing in the vineyard. Because often, you know, for economic reasons, you put it all in one big soup pot, if you will.
Right.
Last year, by the end of September, we already had 300 lots.
I just want to talk a little bit about price. Can you make good wine for less money, or does tech help you do that? Or
tech does allow us to do that. So, for example, we brought in a unit called the Flash Detente Unit. And with that, we can basically heat up the grapes, put them in a vacuum chamber, pop the vacuum on them, and take off the pyrazines. We also lose about 10% of the volume. But what it does is we can make what was basically very, very green, grassy, nasty tasting grapes taste really good. Well, it's not the panacea, the all singing and dancing, but it's a tool, right? So what it does allow us to do is to optimize every stream. And, you know, one of the goals, as Margaret said, was not just to make actually 100-point Cabernet Sauvignon from Vernon, but to make all the wines up to 100-point, even at the $20 level, because we can do that, because we couldn't afford to have a bunch of people picking out, you know, good grapes and bad grapes on a line, but the technology allows us to do that. But it also then allows us to deal with, you know, the grapes that are green or high chlorophyll and find their venue. Maybe it's a rosé, maybe it's sparkling, maybe it's some other channel. But we can optimize. And with that, you know, we can make better and better wines for less and less money.
In episode 3, we'll return to the land, talk about the wines, and take a closer look at the visitor experience lakeside at Frind Estate.